Good morning and welcome to The Weekend. Yes, it is The Weekend. I'm Dave Crane and this is Speak On Stage, or Speak On Stage TV, which is the live version of what I would share with you from the website speakonstage.com. Now, because it's a weekend, I can feel differently. I can even dress differently. This is from the Dubai Rugby Sevens, an event I hosted for about 20 years, going out into the middle of 45,000 party revelers. I won't say they're inebriated because there were kids there as well, but they were just a big party and it was just the best thing ever. And what I was going to say is it's on hold like many things this year. And it will come back as always, as everything will, but in a slightly different way, I think. Hopefully this year we'll be able to have a locals tournament of just local teams as opposed to getting the international stuff coming in. And I think it's important to keep things going as much as you possibly can in the safest possible way for everybody. I don't know how you do social distancing when you're playing rugby, considering what you have to do is knock them down and hold them down and not let them up again until they've learned their lesson and then you get the ball. Well, that was a long time ago I used to play it. But in any sport or anything that you're doing, there's a real challenge. I mean, I remember talking to, I was hosting a conference about 2 weeks ago about the future of sports and the introduction of technology. So predominantly we talked about football, but when we talk about technology, we're talking about 5G, and we're talking about edge technology and the use of the cloud and big data. And I realized by saying that, I've just gone blah, 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 and you've got no idea what it is I'm talking about. But let me explain a little bit more about what I mean by that. So 5G technology, rather than 4G that you've normally got on your actual phone, 5G technology allows you to have much closer internet. So it's in real time, not like you press a button and then something happens a bit later as it streams to you. It happens all around you super quick. Now, people say, you know, 5G, that's responsible for coronavirus. No, it's not. It has its own issues, maybe, with the transmitters being on big poles everywhere. But that's changing slightly because what we're looking at is getting satellites with 5G that are going to be able to track us. So what that means is, for instance, if we go by the end of the year to a lot more auto-driven cars, self-driving cars, then rather than them having to be near a big pole that's got 5G, to be able to telegraph where the car is, if it's gone from satellites, you have about six or seven navigating the car. Now, why is that important for it to be 5G? Why can't we just do it on 4G? Well, 4G will mean that, supposing a car swerves towards you, the car swerves towards you, close to you, and then you take evasive action, there's a good chance that you've hit. When you've got 5G, the minute the car moves, you're able to take evasive action, so you can move around it. And you can't see what I'm doing there with my hands, but it makes perfect sense to what I was trying to hand stuff. So going back to sport, what does that mean for sport? Well, right now, many of the football leagues, many of the different sporting leagues started up again, and they did some very strange things, like having people dressed up. Well, not even people dressed up, they had music being piped in and sound effects being piped in as though the audience was there. I should put in some sports music for this, actually. Okay, so as the audience has been piped in, and so for watching at home, you get to hear the cheers and the roars of what it would be like watching at home. The only thing is the players really hated it. So what is the solution? Well, there's a number of different solutions, one of which is in 5G. You can actually have your phone so it can connect to speakers as big data to the actual event. So if you're at home, you can watch it in real time and say, I hate him, get him off. And it will come out as I hate him, get him off, but only as part of the percentage of, say, 20,000 ticket holders, or however many they have at the event. So that means you actually get a noise from people's homes that's similar to actually what it would be like at the games. It also means that with big data and edge technology, by the way, is the ability to rather than store stuff on the cloud, so therefore you have to send everything up and get everything down, you actually have it stored more locally on servers around you, small ones that are about the same size as, say, a laptop or this kind of size. So what will happen with that is some data will be stored in the cloud, the data you don't need access to all the time, but data you need super quick, you'll be able to access super quick. So in real time, you'll be able to do things. Now that's great for setting up an event, because that means from a point of view, this music is annoying, isn't it? There you go. From the point of view of talking about the ways that you could police an event. So everything from security to saying, oh, there's hot dogs run out over there. Can you make sure that we get more hot dogs over there? Because in real time, you can see it, you know, big data. But also to the fact that, you know, everyone's coming in from that street, from the train station, But we've got a car accident there. We've got a bottleneck. Can we devise a way of getting everybody to come from a different area, send somebody over there, and we'll change it? Or we've got a cluster of people trying to get out of that fire exit. Can we change that fire exit? Boom, 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 boom. And you can automate it, and it's really powerful. So that's great. But it also allows, when you look at artificial intelligence, and look at the way that would work with VR and AR, which is augmented reality and virtual reality, you could actually have it. So if you had the right projector at home, you could sit in your living room, get this, sit in your living room, and you'd be sitting watching the game in front of you, in the middle of the room. And you can see what all the players are going, what's going on, you could cheer and all the rest of it. Now, okay, that's not the same as being at a live match, but it's not bad, is it? As long as you've got a good projector and a good living room, and that's the technology that exists right now with hologram technology that's not being used quite yet. But I find it very exciting. So there's a ton of things with sports that will be coming, and hopefully then we'll be able to get a different version of things going on when it comes to rugby sevens and other cool and groovy events like that. If you just joined me, nice to see you. Welcome to the weekend. It is Speak on Stage. Now, as always, we like to look at something different on the weekend, and I'm not even sure if I'm going to continue doing weekends. This is the first week that I've done the show, and I hope you've enjoyed it so far. As always, we love your comments, we love your thoughts. Please let me know when you arrive. Say hi, Dave, ask me questions, and I'll reply to them in real time, I promise, even though maybe I was a bit lax the last couple of days. I know, you made the effort. I typed it, I pressed send, and you didn't do nothing. I will. But with the weekend, we'll have a slightly different feeling, a different flavour, and I also don't want to incur the wrath of the wife. And for anybody who's married, you know what I'm talking about. Anybody who's met my wife, you know what I'm talking about. Gorgeous Aziza, rightly say that we should have a weekend. So I may be changing the format for the weekend, but right now it's different. So what I want to talk about is here's the thing. If you are a big fan of movies, and I'm a massive movie buff, you will be very excited about the fact that there's lots of movies being streamed to you at home straight away rather than going to the cinema, but also the quality of the movies that you love might not be coming back. But this is where it all gets interesting, because I'm going to share with you, just for this weekend, some brilliant action sequels, that you didn't know were coming, but actually are on the way. Does that intrigue you? Do you like it? Have you done the conversion to box sets? Now, probably you have already. The thing is, about 4 or 5 years ago, the talent, and I'll tell you when it really started, 24. Do you remember 24 with Kiefer Sutherland? And he's talking about bringing it back again. Interestingly enough, if you enjoyed it. 24 was one of the first big budget TV shows that was as good as movies, but you got 24 episodes of it. And what happened was Hollywood and Bollywood and all the rest, I guess, was so caught up in the fact that if you're a star, you're a star. If you're a producer, you're a producer. If you're a screenwriter, you're a screenwriter. That was a really difficult system to navigate through. But as TV became better quality and as box sets on CDs started being sold, what happened was a lot of the key people used to work in Hollywood migrated to the new ultra super quality TV because they could get a bigger wage, and they could get longer contracts, and they could be around longer with a project. Put it in perspective. So you write a script for a movie, and so somebody says, that's a great movie, I look forward to making it. Movie gets made, but what happens is it goes to a couple of different script writers because they wanted just to change it here and change it there. Didn't think your original script was good, and they got some in-house guys. So they put it all together, movie gets made, you're done. You got some fee, feels like a finder's fee, but not great. If you're involved in a TV show, here's what happens. You start off by writing the script. They like it. They greenlight it. They get in somebody who's a proper actor. Not that TV actors weren't proper actors, but maybe a movie star person to host and front the TV show. You now get a job as executive producer because all the characters you created for the pilot now have to be fleshed out and turned into different characters with story arcs and how they all progress together. So that means you've got a whole season's worth of work that you never had before. That's why you've seen the migration of so much talent from normal movies, which are still there and are still good, to these box sets and these huge mega blaster Netflix type specials and really interesting TV shows that have all the special effects and all the quality acting that you'd expect. Because it used to be such like a gap like that. The gap now is almost zero. So in many ways, people won't watch movies because why would you want to wait another 3 years for the follow-up to be made when you can see episode 2 straight after? Hence binging. that makes sense. I hope this works. Let me know if you like it. It's different content from normal week when we talk about business, but this is all about how entertainment generally works. I'll be sharing with you loads of stuff about that because the show is all about how the mindset and the business of operating your head and going out to the public and engaging people really works. Now, if you're a speaker, this makes sense. If you're a non-speaker, you're going, "Oh, that's interesting." But imagine you had to share that idea with somebody because you've got loads of stuff you do in your existing job and you want to share with people what that's all about. Well, that makes perfect sense now, doesn't it? Yes, Dave. Yes, Dave? Okay, in a minute, in a moment, let's talk about movies. So, welcome back. I did promise to share with you the big sequels that are being made at the moment, and this is very exciting if you're a big movie buff like me. First of all, let's start off with Riddick, Riddick 4. Now, if you saw, what's it called? Black something. I've forgotten now, the first Riddick movie. Type it in, and I'll let you know if you got it right. I should type it up, actually. First Riddick movie, starring Vin Diesel, was brilliant. And then it became a Chronicles of Riddick, and then he kept knocking away, bang, 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 give me more Riddick movies. And the character, Richard Riddick, is fascinating because he's had an eye implant so he can see in the dark. He's also completely badass and he can beat and kill everything. And Vin Diesel's completely suited to this because he can be as bonkers as he wants in a future bonkers world. But it kind of sort of dropped out. If you saw the third one, you're like, not so big for that one. But regardless of that, he's got a new script. He said he's very excited about it and he plans to make it. So, well, good luck to you with that. I will still watch it because I just love the original character in the original movie and I can't remember what it's called. Okay, Gladiator 2. Now, this is bonkers. This is something that'll make I don't even know if I've got time to do this. I might just do this and abandon everything else because it's fantastic. Today's show, by the way, in case you didn't know, was all about this. Is meant to be about how to win bigger and better. And to be honest with you, I've hardly touched any of that today because really, we've just been talking about things like sports and movies, and that's kind of better for a weekend feel, don't you think? We may return to that title and just stick on this. Because what I wanted to do today, and I was toying with it, is share with you the original sequel idea for Gladiator 2. Now, if you saw the original Gladiator, it won 5 Oscars, got many millions of dollars at the box office. It was a huge hit. It launched the star Russell Crowe into being like one of the biggest stars on the planet. And he's a brilliant actor and he deserves it all. And by the way, if you haven't got your coffee, by the way, you must have it. I'm using my Christmas mug because that's probably how long we're going to be stuck in lockdown, if not beyond. You got your coffee? If you haven't got your coffee, you're now thinking you wish you had one, aren't you? And if you've got a cup of tea, you're probably thinking, I wish I had a coffee. No, tea's good, coffee's good. Even if you're drinking water, still nice. So, Russell Crowe became a huge star on the back of it. Joaquin Phoenix, who played Commodus, the Emperor, who was a nasty piece of work. Then he got his commodus as well, and was usually on commode. Joke. No? Okay. So, the plan was to have a sequel, but the problem is, if you haven't seen the movie, and I'm going to spoil it for you, the hero dies. But hero dies and everything gets put in place. Hero dies, kills the baddie, saves his lady love, her son survives, the gladiators get saved and freed, and Rome changes. And it's a great movie, but everything is put to bed. That's what makes it such an amazing movie. It doesn't need a sequel, because what are you going to do? Well, apparently, Russell Crowe turned around to his mate Nick Cave. Now, if you're Australian, you'll know Nick Cave. If you're into, not grunge music, but goth music, you'll know Nick Cave. He kind of plays music, so well, that's not Nick Cave, that was me. But and if you know Nick Cave, you'll know what I'm talking about. Nick Cave is an incredibly talented writer and occasional actor and musician. And so he was asked by Russell Crowe to put together a treatment of what Gladiator 2 would be, bearing in mind that the main character, Maximus, goes from general in a Roman Empire to slave to gladiator to changing Rome. And if you haven't seen the movie, you probably want to see it now. And if you have seen the movie, you're probably wanting to see it now. So Nick Cave came up with an idea, and I want you to hold on to something because if you don't know this, this is bonkers. And you will also Google it to tell you that I'm not just making it up, but it sounds made up. So Commodus, not Commodus, that's the Emperor, he's dead. Maximus, who's a gladiator, and he's dead. But he goes to Elysium, which is a place where he wants to go, which is where he's going to see his long-lost wife and child who were killed by Emperor Commodus. Remember that? So he goes there, but actually it's a mega disappointment. It's not the beautiful fields where he's walking and he feels all the grass and the corn under his feet and his fingers. It's actually rain-soaked. Everybody is starving. It's a horrible place to be. He's like, what's this? I won my way here, and it's rubbish. Anyway, he goes on a journey and connects with Roman gods. Stay with me, I haven't finished yet. So he connects with his Roman gods, and he meets Jupiter, and he meets Mars, and he meets some Greek gods as well, because I think the name is wrong in the script. And anyway, he works out that there's another guy, another god, who's come along, kicked a hiney of all the normal gods, and is ruling a place in a really bad way. So he's got to go and take him out. Maximus has got to go and take out this god. Then he ends up going back to the real world after, where he catches up with his long-lost son, who was actually killed in the first... Stay with me, somehow he's back. And then they go to Rome and they have a massive colossal battle where the Colosseum's flooded. And so there's a naval battle going on, and he jumps in and he makes friends with his, you know, the guy, Dmingli Hounslow, I think it's called. The Nubian slave guy is a brilliant actor as well. He's in Guardians of the Galaxy and stuff. He joins him and a lot of other people who survived, and they go up and... Are you still with me? Now, the thing is, it's bonkers. It's utterly bonkers, but it also kind of makes sense if you're going to take him. It's like going into space. If you go into space, we'll make our own rules. But that's not what's going to happen. The actual sequel that they're talking about now, and it's going to have Russell Crowe in. I don't know how. It's meant to be 25 years after he's dead. But maybe he's going to be in flashbacks, or maybe he's going to voiceover, or maybe he's going to embody the character of... Look, I just work here. But it's going to be about the son of the sister of Commodus, all grown up, who needs help. Anyway, as we were saying, Gladiator 2, looking forward to that. Watch this space. It's going to be a very interesting experience for anybody. Should give you one more movie before I finish? I think I will do. I mean, I think I'll save all the other content because it's been quite a long show already. How long have we been going for? Oof, almost 20 minutes of really cool stuff. All right, we'll keep it on entertainment. Anyway, Edge of Tomorrow 2 is going to be made. If you love that, Live, Die, Repeat. It was called, which is actually a better name than Edge of Tomorrow, which is rubbish. Great movie, Tom Cruise. Fighting aliens and has the ability to die and come back exactly the same time every day. So it's like Groundhog Day, but like an alien battle Groundhog Day. I won't spoil it for you, but it's a brilliant movie. And they also included in the production, there's a scene where he goes to see the government, goes to see Brendan Gleeson, and he walks down this street in London, I believe, which is a really well-known street that's always busy. And the production guys, because Tom Cruise apparently... is the most brilliant producer and inspiring and motivating guy. Don't touch the rest of the stuff. We're not going there. And what happened was they said, right, we want to film it in this building, but the street is always so busy with cars and everything. And he said, I believe that you can make it work. So the producers went off and they talked to every single office in that entire street. And they said, look, we're making a Tom Cruise movie. Would you mind not coming into work for 5 hours or so, or half a day or something, to allow us just to film this part, this crucial part of a movie? And they did it. They cleared all the cars, all the people, nobody there, apart from the actors and Tom Cruise. And that's how they managed to do it. It's amazing. You'll see the scene when you watch it again. But apparently Edge of Tomorrow 2 is going to be made. So I look forward to that. Love your comments, by the way. Love the thoughts and things that you're saying. This is all about teaching you to speak. And hopefully as we go along, you'll be understanding how to make interesting content that you can share with others. And if you want to know more, you can always contact me at speakonstage.com. Or if you go to thedavecrane.com, you've got all my contact details. That's thedavecrane.com. Lots of your thoughts and feelings and comments and shares, by the way. We broadcast live every day to LinkedIn, YouTube, Facebook, Periscope into Twitter, and Instagram. Never thought I'd remember all that. So with that in mind, I'm actually going to hold back on some of the content because I think that we've got enough for the weekend. Kind of made sense when I was doing it. I'm going to hold back on all the really juicy stuff I was going to share about business because I want to share with you something for the weekend. Because here's the thing, if you don't have a weekend, it's not a weekend, is it? And the whole point is, it's nice to, if you're in lockdown, every day is like your day off, but it's not because you've got to work. But then the weekend comes, and if you're in lockdown, it seems like your normal day. And if you don't take a break, then you go bonkers because you need to have a weekend to end the week. Otherwise, if you work all the time, you won't realize why you go to work. And then, does that make sense to you? Perfect. Great. Okay. One of the things I'll introduce to you is my dear friend, Ernesto Verdugo. And you can see half his face here or here next to me. Now, when we went into lockdown the first time round, Ernesto and I got together and we said, right, why don't we do something to help people? And he was like, what do you mean? And we said, well, why don't we do a TV show that can really help people to be able to deal with the pandemic and the lockdown and the fear and give them empathy and not sell anything, just give them lots of good information and news that's going around that they could want to get because the news is going to be so political and so depressing. Why don't we just cheer people up? So we decided to go every day to broadcast for an hour or so. And we did it for 50 days. After 50 days in Dubai, we came out of lockdown. I think they did in Texas because he was broadcasting from Houston. We're doing this show. And we've got loads of really cool guests on it. And here's the website. You can see it there. I'll just skim up here. It's toiletpaperdiaries.com, plural, toiletpaperdiaries.com. We're just closing off season two at this moment in time, which is why I've taken a break to do this. But have a look at it because it's everything that you want to see. And all the guests and all the episodes are all there. We went up to 50, then we've done season two. And we've got other shows, spin-offs as well, fast forward. It's worth doing. Now, the thing is, we're on podcast as well, on all your favorite podcasting platforms, whether you use iTunes or whatever it is, it's all there on Apple. But I want to share with you some of the guests that we've had all this time. So amongst the guests that we had, have a look at this. These are to die for. You got Fons Trompenaar, Sharon Lecter. Fons Trompenaar's the godfather of HR, you know, human resources. Sharon Lecter, responsible for working on the Rich Dad Poor Dad, you know, with Robert Kiyosaki. John Carlton, the world's number one copywriter. You got Sarah Mulmadani, who's just an incredible female entrepreneur and business lady and a really cool chick. Can I say chick about royal? I just did. And also we've got Joel Comm there with sunglasses, really well-known internet marketer. Then we've got Raymond Arend, we've got John Briggs. John Briggs is the voice of Siri, by the way. And we've got Gail Kingsbury, who's the agent and event organizer for people like Les Brown, Jack Canfield, all these people. But these are all guests on the show. This is massive. I mean, right now, see this gentleman we've got here. I'll just lift it up a little bit more so you can see. John Matone, that was Steve Jobs' coach. Gentleman in the center, Radzi. Who's Radzi? Radzi is the host in the UK of WWE. Do you know that? Wrestling, all the rest of it. He's massive. Does sports, Blue Pizza, all that other stuff. Chantel Simon, incredible presenter and star as well. Catherine McIntosh, brilliant life coach. Pete Garcia, he's head of the Chamber of the Mexican and American Chamber of Commerce. There's just stars after stars after stars. Some of them you recognize, Alan Wright, TVs and the radio. Mary Henderson, you recognize from LinkedIn, big branding expert. Seth Godin. These are all geniuses, all super people. Trina Rice, Michael Diederich is a huge star in Holland on TV. So these are the kind of people that we have interviewed and joining us on the show as reporters all the way through, especially on the 50th episode. We've got 25 stars on the 50th episode. So if you're looking for something interesting to do, do not be scared. Go along, have a look at the Toilet Paper Diaries. If you go to toiletpaperdiaries.com, then you'll see all these incredible stars and you'll hopefully learn a ton about moving your business into directions that could really help you and change things for you, or even improve things, or give you some tips, or even, at the very, very least, make you laugh. Right, man, it's just about coming to the end of the show. I didn't do the newsy bits because I just thought, well, hold on. We're going in a sort of weekend vibe. And if you're enjoying this show, then let me know. I love having you with me every day. And please share it with everybody so they all get a chance to catch up with it as well. It's really all about helping people to communicate better, to think differently, and grow their business. And if you don't have a chance to grow your business because you're saying, well, I'm in a job, what do you mean grow my business? Create a side hustle. We'll be talking about creating a side hustle in future episodes. And if you're not sure what that is, imagine you had a 1.5 job. So you got your main job here, but the 0.5 is actually an extra job that you do, which is like a hobby, but you can be paid for it if you really try and work on it. And one day that can become your main job. We talked about this early in the week. If not, check up other episodes. They're all there and they'll tell you what you need to know. Meanwhile, I'm going to say sayonara for a little while and have a wonderful weekend. As it's Sunday tomorrow, I may take a break, but I will post something for you anyway. Or maybe I'll just pop up. It depends on whether my family stares at me badly enough. But meanwhile, have an amazing day. And I look forward to catching up with you soon. And whatever you do, wherever you go, make sure you look after yourself. Life is tough out there and it can be indoors. And I feel for you. And that's why every single day I share with you as much as I possibly can to get you through the day, to make me feel good, and for everybody to get closer together. This is Speak on Stage.
My name is Dave Crane. For many years, the biggest fear of most people was to stand up in front of a live audience, speak, communicate, and motivate, and get people to like your brand, your services, and your products. Most people got it wrong, but those who did get it right were seen as leaders. And then the lockdown happened, and now everyone's communicating through different platforms and webinars. And the problem is, if they didn't learn to communicate effectively before, they're even worse now. And they lose audiences who just switch off. And then we went digital, and the possibilities are endless. As a speaker, you can reach any amount of thousands of people, and you can share your message, you can motivate them, and you can change lives. As an event organizer, the possibilities are endless as to how big you can make an event. You don't have to worry about logistics, you don't have to worry about language. You can create something that people can watch in their own time and attend in real time at the same time. As a corporate decision maker and as the owner of a business, you can create your message, you can create a niche, you can get the people from your industry to work with you and make your tribe defined very simply just by putting it online. And what kind of events can you create? You can have a web TV show that dominates your industry and sends your message and your brand across the globe. You can invite in the very best of the industry as your special guests every single day. You can sell through Zoom calls and look after your team the same way. You can also have webinars that unite everybody and tell them about your latest product launches. You can also step into a digital world. Imagine that you could be a digital version of yourself, speaking at a virtual conference. Virtual conferences will change the game. Not only can you speak in a big auditorium where people from their laptops are all present in front of you, but you can also have spin-off rooms, meeting rooms. You can display the latest products. I can also have boardroom meetings at the same event. You could do them in real time, but also leave all the content available for people to comment on or review at a later date. And the cost is a fraction. You can go global from your laptop. These are the possibilities that are for you, whether you're a speaker, an event organizer, a small business, or a big decision maker. You need to think about the new version of you and how that will impact your brand and take your opportunities to a brand new level. The possibilities are endless now that we're completely digital. You can be online and offline, on stage and off stage, and your speaking ability will drive your message, drive your brand, and change the world. It's time for you to now learn to speak on stage. We'll be right back.